Oh, wow.
Good morning.
Good morning. Thank you for having us.
Good.
Thank you.
We're so happy to see you.
Yeah.
I'm so happy to see all of you. This is exciting.
Yep.
Yeah.
Calling here.
Just a quick announcement, because Jonathan's on his way. If anybody was here because of the GG Reggie Bannister panel, because we had swapped rooms, that is actually next door. But if you're here, you come to the right place.
Yes, I love Reggie and GG Bannister, so I totally understand if you're here for that.
It's next door.
It's amazing. Friends of mine.
Hi. How are we? Are we having a great time at TIERSTEN?
Yes, yes. Anthony's watching.
I think I've been to every single one.
Yeah.
Thanks so much.
For sure.
Oh, my gosh.
Each of them has started.
Oh, boy, there he is. Yeah, look at that face.
Don't be shy. You guys know FELISSA?
No. You don't know each other.
Yes, you will be so bad again. I apologize ahead of time. So sorry for my comment.
I invented body
all over, yeah.
Hey, they actually hit her with that thing.
In 1982, didn't matter. They were like, yeah, get her.
Like, no, nail her.
That's great. And the water's cold. Throw more.
It was like when I was getting ranked up against the lit thing.
When we're in the cooks, you know, the little cook.
If you look at the scene, you see the end of the potato box. Because Robert was just enjoying me getting thrown.
You look at her and you're like, hello, how terrifying!
Yay! It was a like that, but they kept hitting her. They're like, it has to look real. And I'm like, why are you hitting her with a water bottle? Which just increased my rage. So are you guys surprised by, even after all these years, that people still like just love the movie? The characters?
Sort of, but not.
Oh, I'm still like, what? What are we talking about?
37 years later, we made this little movie. It felt like we just went to camp and had a great time, and that was the end.
But it was camp, right?
It was camp.
It was camp.
And your mom was feeling, your mom was feeling. Stage, right? Like it's kind of like a.
Oh, she only parent on the site.
Yeah.
You know? Because we dated, which is a terrible idea. 13, 17, not, you know.
And I was a really young
17.
Hey! I was a young. Of course.
Yeah, we don't want to get into
it. It'll all be in the documentary.
Yeah. You know, I mean, I was six.
Our demographic is the same as ours. That is really cool. And, you know, people always say to me to go, you know, they're like, oh, you know, so only like old people know that movie. I'm like,
yeah.
You know what? It's people like James H. Denise, you know, Killtown, who brings a whole new generation to watch the older films.
Yeah, we only had 4 million views. That was a little bit. 4 million.
Yeah, he's amazing. You all get to see.
He's worried about
it. Okay, well, so am I.
That's another
matter. I think we're going to be our
therapist. No need to worry.
Yes. Jimmy, when you killed it last night at the karaoke.
Well, that takes perfection to be good. Let's do it on the John.
I owned a bar that served the first pint of fat tire in the street. And the southern beers that are now a big deal. And this is my best friend. If you guys don't know, but we talk every day. It doesn't matter where we are in the world.
Right, so you guys did Sleepaway Camp, and like at a real camp, you make lifelong friends, you know, minus some of the things that happen.
We are, we're close with the whole crew and the cast. It's one big family. But that's how it is really on movie sets. I mean, you get so close, you're put together for such a small amount of time, and so much has to happen.
But it's intense. You know, it's scary as hell, and you're all, Felissa can tell you what I said the first time we walked down the stairs.
In Sleepaway Camp, when we're coming down the steps, he's like, I think I'm done. I don't want to make this movie. He was terrified of Aunt Martha.
Imagine being raised by that woman.
Yeah.
That's an actor here. He's like, no,
I was like, I don't know how to react to her.
from the party, and then suddenly we made the movie all over again 20 years later, and now the party was in my cabin.
Hey.
So it was,
oh my god,
it was fun.
Party in our
cabin. Yeah, the party did not end. Yeah, the crew was like, party in your cabin tonight? And I was like, no.
Was that one of the room also?
No, that was in Starlight, PA. We were at another camp.
I wrote a song.
And he and I had a great time being there with Paul D'Angelo and Robert Hilton again.
I did a glorified cameo and was there for 5 weeks.
Yes.
You were there.
He was there.
Like Robert's like, you're the glue. And I'm like, what?
Very hot.
I felt like I was the glue because I was stuck. But people said to me, what was it like? And I said, well, I got to hang out with Melissa for 5 weeks. And that was cool.
Yeah,
we just, you know, we are family. We know that. And it is what it is.
Yay.
And then the sequels, 2 and 3, you auditioned. You were into it.
Well, you know, it's funny because I think I was about 16 or 17, and I had just applied early admission to NYU. And it was the only school I really wanted to go to. I wanted to study at the School of the Arts to really see if I wanted to pursue an acting career as an adult rather than just continue as a child. So when they offered the role to me, I read with Michael Simpson, the director, and honestly, I sucked. I was so shitty at that character because she's wisecracking, and it was more comedy.
Yeah, they changed the tone.
They changed the entire Angela character. And I sort of looked at him and said, I don't think this is right for me. And he loved Pamela Springsteen, and I think she's amazing. And I loved that. And I went on to to school and went back to make return to Sleepaway camp. So kind of all up there.
Yeah. We went to the same school.
Yeah. And we never spoke at NYU.
Well, we met once at a party.
Yeah, there was like a long period where we, you know, it was awkward.
We do this every now and again.
Did you guys go to acting school together?
Well, we were there at the same time.
I was a freshman and he was a senior.
Yeah. Molly Shannon and Adam Sandler went at the same time.
Adam Sandler.
Molly was in my circle of square.
And I lived like a few floors down from Adam Sandler. So
we lived in the same dorm.
And played guitar and just smoked
cigarettes.
He smoked a lot of cigarettes and he was like the coolest person.
Awesome. Adam is sweet. That's all I can say about him. It's just incredibly kind.
Oh.
So, when you guys got the script, what did you guys think? Like, this is messed up. Like, it was the ending. You guys knew how it was going to end.
Wasn't I the only one who had the initial, like, full script?
No, I read the entire script and I saw the ending.
And I was dead.
And he died in the original script. I put the page up on my Instagram recently. It says, Ricky is dead. And then they decided while we were filming, let's keep Ricky alive because maybe. Because
Robert needed somebody to go bowling.
You know, they were doing different things to make it not seem like it was you.
Right.
You know, like using John's hands and the bully.
It's, and Felissa, more than I, has, decided that Ricky is certainly. If not complicit, aware of what happened.
How many people have seen Sleepaway Camp? Okay, how many people think Ricky knew what was going on?
What
might happen?
I think, of course, he knew. We shared a bathroom.
It's so weird to return to Sleepaway Camp when Ricky's talking about visiting. That, to me, is something I still think about. I'm like,
honestly, I didn't know that was you at first. The thing you're
crying about. As the sheriff?
Yeah.
So has anyone seen, I know Return to Sleepaway Camp is, not everyone's favorite, but thank you.
Well, for me, I didn't skip to one three.
Well, it's the same tone. It was written and directed by Robert Hunsick in the original, and I played Nan in the movie. And I went through 6.5 hours of makeup every day.
Every day.
And then 3 hours to take it off. So I worked every day for about 45 minutes. And it was really fun playing this dude. You know, it was such a fun character. I had a voice bond.
She was Barney Fife, for God's sakes. I wanted to say RoboCop, but
RoboCop. And he had the mustache on, just like the guy in the first one.
She was so sexy.
Smallest sheriff.
It was so weird. They done not seem menacing.
I came on set and they were like, let's see if anyone knows it's really you. Everyone's like, why is Felissa dressed up like an asshole?
So if a Sleepaway Camp came out with this, the same story, around this time, how do you think people would react?
I think it's very topical. I think it's a film that has so many amazing social, issues that we deal with today, with bullying, with gender identification, so many things. I think it's actually a great film that should be remade.
One of the things I always people say, you can't make remake Sleepaway Camp because of the surprise ending. Well, people don't watch a movie 100 times for the surprise ending. The movie depicts what it's like to be a teenager. It's terrifying. It was like the antithesis of what I actually went through at camp. Because I was not the coolest kid at camp. And in Sleepaway Camp, I got to be big man on campus the whole time. Because I walked on water. The movie is so real. So many levels, and we were at camp filming, and I was eating the mess hall. That huge pot of water with the corn, we ate that corn.
And
the flies that were on the fly strip.
Yeah, I'm not planting.
funny.
No flies were burnt in the making of this film.
You know, let's call it what it is. It's a fun, cheesy movie. We all talk like this in the movie, so it's fun. Like, the outfits
like
are
that.
Super 80s and hilarious. But, you know, when you really bring it down, I think the reason it still resonates with an audience is because we all feel like Angela at some point. We all have those insecurities. We all feel like we've been picked on or hurt. And I think it's the best revenge story. Not that I, you know, I'm going out killing everyone, but I think we all
do.
Sort of embraced her and took on that feeling. Yeah, get that. You know, there's.
I've said this before to Melissa. I said it's the only film in that slasher's era where you're rooting for the antagonist.
Mm-hmm.
Angela is. Everybody loves Angela. No, there's no hatred towards Angela, even at the end of the movie. Yeah. And that's bizarre because, you know, every other slasher film of the 80s was have sex, get killed. Yeah, whatever. But it was in Sleepaway Camp, I didn't know it at the time. I didn't know it was Sleepaway Camp. So I don't even know if Robert knew it was Sleepaway Camp.
I don't think so. Movie.
Yep.
I don't think we realized
that. I didn't realize how twisted Robert's mind.
Yeah. Or he said that it would change and change the scene with the kids.
See, I like that scene.
Yeah.
Which I like
it just added to the intensity. You know, especially with the score throughout the whole movie. You know, all
so
it's really,
oh,
it's like
the
score,
and that was done with a full orchestra. You know, like none of that. Like,
we all got paid $3, but not orchestra. That's part of the
budget. If it was
remade, it's true.
If Sleepaway Camp was remade, who would you guys want to cast as like this? Why?
I would say one of my daughters. They're 12 and 14, and they've been in a lot of the films I produce. And they're in the Slayer videos that I produced. They get killed by Danny Trejo, and they're so intense in it. And I think they really do. It'd be a great fit for that. It would be fun to watch my children play the role.
You have to come full circle.
Yeah, it would be really great to watch.
I'm so on the fence on this one.
Danny DeVito.
I think I would love to see my son do it, but I also am terrified to see what you do it.
Yeah, because as Melissa knows, in real life, I don't swear pretty much at all.
You got it all out.
Yeah, I got it all out from Sleepaway Camp. But I always said Ricky swore with intent, which is not the way people swear now. You know, when he was swearing, he was not using the F word as an adjective. He was swearing.
Did you feel funny swearing like that?
I still struggled with it then, if you remember. Because I was like all brooding.
Wasn't that your audition? He had you.
Yeah. Like, but Felissa can tell you about my moods.
You have a band, right?
Yeah. Sounds about it. Well, I don't have a band anymore. I just, I'm a musician.
Okay.
I've been writing music for years and years. It's just part of who I am.
He's an amazing musician. You can find, you know, his music.
It's on all over the internet. You can find it on
Spotify.
They're all dark.
Loving. Okay. And there's a new Shout Factory. Maybe released it. They wanted your song.
Yeah, they put my. I did a music video that we shot in 6 days. Called The Princess, where I played every instrument. For Felissa has been such a supporter of mine. I mean, when I first started traveling to Los Angeles, she came to every show.
Oh. The band is called Bambi's Apartment. I was certain that I was Bambi. Like, that's me. I'm gonna sing. It's like terrifying. But I love something. I'm completely committed.
But, so she came to my room when I played. She can't think it's calling. So, and I mean, I have a show next week in Staten Island. But
Staten Island, terrifying friend.
Hey.
This movie is something that it took me forever to learn to embrace. And she taught me that.
Oh.
Because time passes, when you something that people remember forever. You should respect it.
Yeah, like I said, you know, it touches so many generations, you know, and it's just as good the first time you watch it as the 40 and 50.
That's what I love about it. I'm so distanced from it now that I can watch it as a fan and just be like, because like when they told me they were playing it today, I was like, screaming out of nowhere.
I'm just going to really watch it. I'm just watching the ending like, oh my God.
What is up with the hey bob rebob thing?
Yeah.
I was trying to explain that to John. That was, as a musician, that was so offensive to me. It's like, hey bob. Hey bob a rebob. Like, do you not know what that is?
No.
He had no idea.
And can you explain it to all of us?
Yes.
It's a song for the band. It's supposed to be hey bob rebob, hey bob rebob. The man was tone deaf. And I was stuck in that tub of water while he's trying to figure out how to sing.
That was filmed, that whole canoe, while he's under the canoe, it was filmed in a large tank. So they warmed the water.
Yeah, warmed
for the deepest. I didn't think that way.
It was so cold. There was shrinkage.
And then apparently they shot the end scene right after.
Yeah.
Yeah, I had pneumonia, so they had to get it done.
So, I think we just open it to the crowd now. It's
Q&A.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Crowd strikes like Donald Trump.
Oh, oh boy. You have any questions?
Come on.
Here we go.
I'm just curious. You touched on the audition process, and we all heard that they were very unusual.
Well, so my audition was, it was so fun. We went into, they held the auditions at the NYU business school. And we walked in and there were a whole bunch of little girls in the lobby. A lot of the girls who were on Broadway doing Annie had been auditioning. So I walked in and Robert called me in and he just said, could you just stare at the wall? And I was like, okay, that's cool.
She has a gift, by the way. She can stare for minutes at a time without blinking.
I did stare for a long time. And he was like, okay, now can you do the chocolate bar? And I thought it would be funny. It was the whatchamacallit scene. So I was trying to add like some fun to it. So I was eating the bar and then I was like, eating my teeth. He was like, all right. And I just really liked him. He and I connected. And I thought he was a cool person. And I left and I said to my mom, okay, I think I got that. She was like, no. All right, listen. This is your first audition. You didn't get it. So just shop. And then I got a call back and I had to go in and meet with the producers and they had me do a scene with Paul on the beach where they had me running and like, so you're running from another boy and you're, you know, just playful. And then they called and said I got the part. And you know, just it felt very natural. It was a very organic process. So, and I really, I loved Robert during the audition and he and I are very close to this day.
Yeah, he told me to tell him all.
Yeah,
I had a lot of rage. I still do. And I think his hair went from brown to white. But it was because I actually looked at him after he asked me, and I said, are you serious? I was like, my parents just got divorced and stuff. Like, I was just all bitter. And he's like, no, tell me all, for real. And I just started screaming at him, so that whole scene wasn't even scripted. And I just ripped into him with everything I had. I walked out and I remember I was with my great two friends, Diane and Simone in New York City business school. I walked out and I said, I think I'm not fair. And rest is history.
Yeah.
And they were like, why? And I said, you told me to tell him off. And they go, oh, you definitely got it.
Any other questions?
Yeah.
Direction that you all receive. I mean, it was like you had a lot of freedom to kind of go with it. I've always wondered, you know, whether being you in the gymnasium, just staring at them, like, what was that like? And the other question I got is, like, very on Martha's affect role. I've never seen anything like that again. So I'm just curious on those 2 points.
Well, Robert was very specific and certainly meticulous in how he saw each character. And about Martha, he kept telling her to go bigger and bigger. So
she
started
here. She was freaking out, like, what is he making me do?
And that costume. I mean, that was just incredible.
Yeah, it was something out of Alice in Wonderland.
The beret and the mouth and the sweater. It was just so awful. So she started like, Richard, Angela, he's like, no, bigger, crazier. And truthfully, she's the real monster of the film. So it makes sense for Aunt Martha to be completely off the rocker and crazy. I would actually love to see a prequel to this movie so we can hear the entire backstory to Aunt Martha.
Yes.
Yeah.
And her insanity. Because she's just one, you know, crazy lady.
She said everything is emotional.
Yes, she does.
Oh,
she's the monster.
She's a horrible person.
She's the one who sets the tone and sets the entire, you know.
Plus, she didn't even give me one bag of chips.
That's no chips.
What's up with the apples?
She definitely was. But with me, he worked very closely with me because he felt like if I didn't convey like the pain and the hurt and a whole ton of vulnerability, it would just all fall flat. So he, in every scene, every moment, we did a lot of takes. And especially because Angela was very far away from who I am as a person. I'm like, hey, let's all hug and have fun.
Yeah, there were opposites.
And then, during the takes, I had to really come in and just really leave myself at the door. So it was sort of it wasn't a struggle, but it was definitely, I was working very hard to give him what he wanted. And so I thank him. I thank him for the role.
Was the nicest guy in the world and an intellectual.
He was such a lovely man. And
he would sit and read like Shakespeare.
Very good, yes. He was a trained actor. I always remember him sitting in the corner with a novel. I don't know that we could ever get away from a character like that today. I mean,
and he
can,
owned it, right?
Right?
He absolutely owned it. And, that was so stark. And when I look back at it now, it's so weird, right? But why not? That's what movies are supposed to be, right? It's not reality, it's hyper-reality. And so, yeah, it's great. But when people ask me, they say, what was a pedophile doing at a camp? I go, have you ever been to camp? In the 80s? He said, that was the norm. It was just, there was so much repressed sexuality back then.
But the entire movie is that. I think it's just one big homoerotic festival, isn't it?
The whole nudity is men's butts.
The only sexual tension and excitement is between the dads, in bed together, and all of that.
And where did Robert come up with that one?
Because he's never, and that's why we're also doing, not to even segue, but we are doing a documentary called Angela, and that's something that we would like
she
to talk
to
about.
She wants me to tell the truth.
We will reveal a lot about, behind the veil, and a lot of interview every character, and I do feel like we need to hear from Robert. What was he really thinking with this film? Was he intentionally putting that out there, or did it just happen? I don't believe it did.
Well, I think we learned a lot with Return to Sleepaway Camp because he completely flipped the script, where the antagonist was the least likable character in the world. Whereas in Sleepaway Camp, obviously, Angela is really benevolent, kind, and everybody likes her. And Robert, I think, just likes, he's like the person who pets the cat the wrong way.
Yes.
So is that going to be crowdfunded, or can you tell us more about that?
Yeah, that it's produced by Michael Perez. He's done a lot of the docs, Nightmare on Elm Street. And,
that was amazing.
2013. So he's an incredible producer and director. He will be at the helm of making sure that we tell a true story. And I think we need an interview with Pamela Springsteen, and we need an interview with the gentleman who was the real star of the movie, The Penis.
That guy has never come forward. Ever.
I'm gonna find him.
It was so horrible for him. I think he suffers forever scarred.
Shrinkage.
Got $250, a bottle of Jack, stood there with my mask on and shaved his body. And just cried hysterically that night. And I remember being
was
there
giggling.
So sad. These assholes. He was laughing. I felt so badly. situations that occur in schools. And I think that's a mental health issue that we're dealing with. And it truly has nothing to do with our end of the work.
Yeah, and as listeners, I lived in Colorado.
I was
Columbine went down. It is a mental health issue, but it's not just a mental health issue. I don't think film inspires people to do the violence they do. I think it's so multi-layered. So let me get this out of my head. I think bullying is still a huge crisis in our culture, and I think people feel lost and alone. I would hope that I think Sleepaway Camp is a message against bullying. It's cautionary tale. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes.
It saddens me that people feel so.
Well, there's a right way to handle things, and there's a wrong way.
Yeah, it's just so unfortunate that we I guess there's people in our society who just feel completely disconnected. So if we can repair that.
And a lot of us, you know, we watch horror movies to escape reality, more or less, you know.
Yeah, I mean, and I've said this a million times.
Our
movie fans are like the most kind people I've ever met in my life.
The most stable.
It's just because they get experience.
You guys,
And so, I mean, one person can't change that.
No.
Well, I think that's the point, though, and that's what we're saying. I mean, there's always going to be influences to anyone, right?
It's part of life.
Yeah. But, you know, if we're going to start blaming horror movies and videos, no, of course, it might be part of their psychosis.
Yeah,
I mean, you know, I'm, I'm, I'm,
I'm a mom. I am a person. I like to believe a compassionate person.
Yeah.
And anytime I see a person stub their toe, I'm ready to cry and fall over and repair. So for me to, you know, except for Jonathan. So yeah, it's just terrible, and I would do anything to try to help. And any person who I've said on many podcasts that I do, and I have my own podcast. Called Casualty Friday. There's a plug. But I, you know, I often say my door is open. Like I'm a pretty open individual who, if anyone needed to talk or needed any kind of help, not that I'm.
Yeah, I think she and I are on the same page. Compassion is probably the number one.
I love people. Everyone has a big, beautiful heart. Perhaps you were in a situation in life that, you know, hurt us or broke us. Or, I mean, I'm open to things that have happened in my life. You know, I've been through a lot, and I just try to be brave and go through each day as kindly and happily as I can. And I'm fortunate that I get to meet beautiful people, you know, at conventions and in the work that I do.
Wait on me.
Yes, and thank you for it. And I call it comedy today. You watch Sleepaway Camp.
love going to screenings for Sleepaway Camp because the laughter is so great with a huge audience. We just, I mean, and I'm giving commentary the whole time, like, oh my god, like the entire
show.
Ronnie, I mean Ronnie's red sweatsuit is the best part of Sleepaway.
Oh, god. Oh, I still
love that. And he insisted on wearing that.
And
you wore that same
t-shirt. His pants, the t-shirt.
Oh my gosh. He's such a crazy guy.
What on
earth?
And those were his clothes.
We all had to bring our own
shirt. He would show up with those clothes. No, Robert made me wear a lot of stuff.
The hat. The big, ugly cowboy hat.
Oh, you have the balance on your head.
Yeah.
I don't like that.
But I thought the kills were really fun and very, they sort of represent probably what a teenager would think of, you know, the curling iron.
Yeah, it was nightmarish though. I mean, the actual practical effects that they had to do were so difficult. You know, like when they did Barbie, they had to build a fake floor.
The cook, they had to put him on a floor and they had all these wires and whatnot going into his face. Bubble
with
up.
Latex.
And,
it's unbelievable.
It was so cool. I remember sitting at the edge of that fake floor like, whoa, this is the greatest thing ever. And that's where my love for horror movies began. Because I actually got to watch the effects me creating right there. I'm like, oh, this is the most amazing
thing
ever.
And it was, as it was Ed French, who, you know, was later nominated for an Academy Award. He did Creep Show too. And he said to us at the Blu-ray screening, he said, and was my grounding achievement,
yes.
Because we had to do so much with so little.
Yeah.
And Robert was so brutal. Like, he made it work.
Yeah. But, and he was molding a penis in the very beginning.
I was doing that at
they
home.
They were the entire point. They were going to strap a penis on his hand. Which makes zero sense, because I am a chick with tits.
Yeah,
so how in the world is that going to work?
I mean,
like standing there.
What you do in your private place, that's fine.
It just seems so crazy. My own place.
Well, she's not.
Yeah, she's not going to wear that strap on.
And it wasn't me.
Which, you know,
I did do all the killing.
I didn't do that. Yeah, well, the curling irons, that was obviously new.
Well, in the Blu-ray, you finally see it's like so ridiculously obviously me, you know? But that was my whole thing from the start of the movie. I said, no one's going to buy this because Melissa's too pretty. That was my whole issue. And I kept telling Robert, I'm like,
wrong.
She's too pretty. No one's going to buy this. And I was
I
totally
thought
wrong.
I looked a little bit like a little boy.
Yeah.
I think I had like a little bit of a hand.
No, your butt did not look like
a boy. Oh, yeah, definitely. You're so awful. As I said, this is not the normal butt.
I started.
And I said it's because I ate all the Fryhoppers chocolate chip cookies that they had on set.
Oh,
so from the beginning of the movie, I had like not such a big butt, but at the end, when I'm getting out of the water, it's like ass first. So I'm like, yeah, it's struggling to get my ass out of the water.
That's
what
I want to be. Still not.
So Angela, over here.
Okay. I've always heard this. I never knew if this was true or not. So, you know, having worked on the movie, you might be able to answer this conclusively. At least we think you do. Is it true they shot and then didn't use a super gnarly shot of, like, Bert and Judy? Because I have heard that, but I never knew if that was true or not.
That is 100% not true.
Okay.
I'll tell you why. Because Robert Hilton, we shot on 35mm. And it's super expensive. Anything
so you
shot
yeah.
was on that screen.
Okay.
There was no burnt duty. And the other reason is there would be an entire
gross.
Set of makeup that we'd have to
yeah.
apply. And it would be nasty.
Gross.
That would be nasty. And it wouldn't be to her face.
Yeah, well, see, that's what I had heard. That they were like, no, this is too gross. We can't use this.
Yeah.
So,
no,
okay.
I mean, the whole premise of that.
No,
yeah,
so
it was disgusting. But,
hands go up and shake. And
I like that she does the whole chiller theory.
I call them jazz hands.
I think that's the thing that seemed so intense. You know, it was.
Yeah,
it was suggested,
less,
right?
More.
Yeah.
You know,
well, and that's what they did with so many of the
There was scenes where you really saw stuff like Artie's Blisters, and then there were scenes where it was just suggested.
Yes.
And that was brilliant. Yeah,
so you've heard the fan site wrong then, I think. So I think like one of the two fan sites is where I got
them. Yeah, they all think I'm they all think I'm a killer too. Oh wait, so this was
they say that he's
or at least so do you think Angela killed anybody?
No.
So there's that scene on the boat, right, when you guys start. So there's 8 years later. What the frick happened in those 8 years when you were living as Angela?
Well, maybe the film should be called.
And I'm going to summer camp.
So we should see the 8 years.
Yeah, I'm going to summer camp every summer without you. And suddenly Aunt Martha goes, "No, you're going with Richard."
No, I just think at that time she was probably supposed to be like 12 years old, and that was the first time Aunt Martha felt it. Okay, right.
What did you do in the summer when you weren't in
camp? She worked at Orange
Julius. So that question actually sparked like something in my head. So with film being expensive, and you know that didn't happen. I actually never heard that before. But
yeah.
Do you
that's
know,
a cool theory.
But you have heard that?
I haven't heard that one.
Yeah.
That was, like I said, that was just from some fan site. Like I never knew if it was true.
Tell them to call me.
I'm not gonna
with your comment of knowing that, you know, he used everything he shot, the MPAA had to come in and take a look at the film before it came out. Do you know of anything that you shot or someone shot that didn't make? Like we've never seen that since we made it.
No, but there was that was a huge issue.
That was a huge issue when the MPAA watched it. He said, for sure, he said, I'm done. Like, I'm getting an X rating, and we're not ever going to see this movie. And they called him, and he was like, here we go. And he got on the phone, and they said, well, we have terrible news for you. And they said, it's my sensors. You're one way, guys. You have an R rating. And said, well, I guess I'm just going to have to deal with that.
He couldn't believe it.
He was
so
happy.
Utterly convinced that it was going to be an X-ray out. If you're not going to take out the penis.
If you're seeing that last shot, what else can you talk about?
Yeah,
you're seeing a full frontal little boy nude in 1983.
Yeah.
Evidently, that is your penis.
They saved their outrage for Sleepaway Camp 3 for summer, which isn't even that graphic a movie if you see the uncut version and the stuff they cut. It's like, what fucking
I heard there
that?
Was boots. Were there boots?
There were boots, but all
no,
the guest scenes were
in this movie.
Yeah. They left the boots and all the gore got
that was
out.
The weirdest
like,
thing, though.
Very awesome.
I've never seen 2 or 3 as close as, but...
That makes
me sad. Lots of boots.
But it's like, it's... I mean, it's like the guy... Betrayed the idea of the first film because there's no boobs in the first film, and you know, maybe
I think that's
scene.
Great.
Yeah,
and she's
we made a movie, a horror movie without boobs. Yay!
Yeah.
I like
yeah.
Boobs. I voted for him in the last election.
Me too.
In Return of Sleepaway Camp, or touched upon the Return of Sleepaway Camp.
No. And I think she's such a fantastically colorful, wonderful character.
She's
so
old, but I've been Alan's mother
in the first movie, really. So,
again, I'd like to, and maybe I should just write it and produce it.
Hey, yes.
Yeah.
Aunt Martha. I don't care about the remake. Let's see. I love prequels because I'm the kind of person when I watch a movie and I'm completely immersed in the story, like Mulholland Drive. I leave and I have coffee for like 12 hours analyzing every detail. I want to know, and I still do 37 years later, I want to know what the hell was going on with that woman? What's her backstory? Who's her lover? Who's not her lover? Who died? Who were the kids?
That's
why
I was
asking
about the 8 years.
For God's sake.
It's called Aunt Martha and the 8 years. It's more of a lifetime story.
I want to know the Mel backstory.
Yes.
Can you show us a little Mel? I think he's
not Mel. Not Mel. I can see the 8 years. I had him. I let him go.
You need a Meg, I can do Meg.
Yeah, what the hell is that song?
She washes her neck.
I swear to God, I'm in the only
movie with completely musically
I think of that song.
Yeah, because she was like, Robert was like, sing something, and Melissa's like, and Kathy was like, I don't sing. I was like, you don't sing in this
show. I have a really good time. I think that we should all sing in the movie. Apparently, everybody hates that. I'm like, I was 13.
I would rather be kissed and drink than have to listen to that song.
We all know.
So we have time for a few more questions, then we have to wrap it up, unfortunately. Okay. Or can we go with.
Yeah, you said it was practical effects. How did you do the bees?
Oh my God, that was a nightmare. Because most of the bees died.
Light dark. Be sad. It wasn't a nightmare. They brought in a bunch of bees.
And it was too cold, and they died.
Well, they had to come from.
The bees died. We have destroyed the environment.
They
in
did bring in a bee wrangler. It was so amazing to watch this. You know, the wrangler came in. Everyone.
They took about half the time on the mask Billy that they did on Felissa, so thankfully there were enough bees to cover it, so it didn't matter.
Yeah.
But no, a lot of the bees died overnight. Robert was freaking out. It was too cold.
So they put a bunch of dead bees on and flew around.
We all had money.
Question for John. It's a really quick question. So if Angela was living with Aunt Martha and you, right?
My guess, what I gather.
Did Ricky know that Angela? What?
That's not the question for me, actually.
That's for Melissa, okay.
Yes.
Okay. Listen.
Does anyone agree with me?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
I think that's the only way we can really figure everything, you know.
You have to walk
away everything else
once.
Yeah.
Because he's so emphatic with Angela, like saving me and taking care of me and protecting me and making sure I'm insulated from everything else.
He's a little over the top.
If he did know, I don't think.
This is one of the most incredible things for me is that I still think about this.
We're gonna have to talk about that later.
But I question it. I think about it. He must have known something.
Okay, it is time to wrap it up.
Mm-hmm.
And now,
the clock.
Oh my God.
You heard the work
and
stuff?
Get it!
The entire budget.
Get it! We
heard the whole budget.
We
knew exactly what it was.
Yes, yes.
Thank you so much.
Yes. 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 Woo!